It's the biggest mammal invasion that's ever happened on planet Earth, as far as we know.
Whoa.
People talked about the land being covered by a moving grey blanket. Within 50 years, they had covered 2/3 of the Australian continent.
They're in our cartoons, they're on our cereal boxes, and all over our children's stories. Rabbits are adorable, but bring them where they don't belong, and you're asking for trouble. This is the story of how 13 rabbits took over Australia, and how biocontrol helped us fight back. I'm Shane Campbell-Staton, and this is Human Footprint.
The rabbit has arguably been the most destructive non-human animal to ever arrive on the Australian continent.
Whoa.
They have sent animals and plants to the brink of extinction and beyond.
Rabbits aren't native to Australia, and you'll never guess how they got here.
In 1859, Thomas Austin decided that he would like to do a bit of hunting on his country property. On Christmas Day in 1859, Thomas let 13 rabbits out.
You know the exact day?
Yep, we know the day, we know the number. From there, they ran wild.
Australia was like an all-you-can-eat bunny buffet, and they reproduce, well, like rabbits. The environmental and economic costs of this bunny bonanza were staggering. Rabbits eat plants from top to bottom, roots included. So before long, there was nothing holding the soil down.
Cities and towns were blanketed with huge dust storms, liberated by the little incisors of the bunnies.
Of course, people also figured out a way to make a profit off of them. Just a heads up, in case you're squeamish, the rest of this episode has got quite a few dead rabbits in it, but I promise they're part of a remarkable story. So let's get back to it.
They went in the freezer and they got shipped off to feed people in Europe.
And rabbit meat was just the beginning.
If you had walked through the streets of London in the 1920s, most of the gentlemen who lifted their hats to the ladies were wearing Australian rabbit fur on their head.
But all that trapping barely made a difference, and rabbits reached plague proportions.
So Australia turned to its scientists to find methods of biological control. And that's where you get the story of myxomatosis.
Myxomatosis is a rabbit disease caused by the South American Myxoma virus, a relative of smallpox. Researchers wondered if Myxoma could solve Australia's rabbit problem. They were cautious, first making sure Myxoma couldn't infect any native species, and then testing the virus in small, isolated rabbit populations. Myxoma was finally unleashed in early 1950, and by the end of the year, people began to report hundreds, then thousands, and ultimately millions of dying rabbits.
The piles of dead rabbits were stinking out pastoral properties, and the spread traveled hundreds of kilometers in just a few short months.
Months, whoa.
Months. It was okay. A big success.
More than 99% of Myxoma-infected rabbits died. Agriculture and ecosystems rebounded as the rabbit population crashed.
It's one of the most successful examples of biocontrol, using one species to control another, in history.
But 70 years later, rabbits are still an inescapable part of Australian life.
We have got quite a healthy population of rabbits in our urban reserves within Canberra.
Ian Lenon is a wildlife manager. He's using heat-sensitive cameras to help locate and dispatch rabbits.
Everyone behind the shooter.
Ooh, yep, I got him.
That's a female rabbit by the look of it.
Okay.
It's hard to watch, but the rabbits killed in these control programs provide important data.
What are you testing for here?
So we take blood, for example. We can analyze that later. for antibodies against the various viruses that are circulating.
Okay.
So we can see what was active in the area.
And it turns out Myxoma is still here. So why hasn't the virus finished the job?
Biological control is not an eradication tool. It's a management tool.
Meet Tanja Strive. When she's not spending time with her very pampered chickens, she's working at CSIRO, Australia's National Science Agency, on the next generation of rabbit biocontrol. Because Myxoma isn't as effective as it used to be.
There is a window of time where the biting insects can pick up the disease and transmit it to the next animal. So as soon as the rabbit's dead, it's of no interest to a mosquito anymore.
Okay.
The first strain of Myxoma was actually too lethal for its own good. It killed so quickly that it limited its own transmission. But new strains evolved that killed their hosts more slowly. Since the less deadly strains spread more easily, they gradually replaced the older strains. Just like the more infectious Delta and Omicron variants of COVID-19 replaced earlier strains of that virus.
Today, Myxoma virus probably still kills a very large amount of rabbits, but on its own, it would not be sufficient. So we need to continuously look for alternative tools and strategies.
One of these alternatives emerged in the 1990s.
So the Khaleesi virus causes an infectious hepatitis. It's one of the most virulent viruses that we know to affect mammals. It was on track to be released, but it actually got away from an offshore island in Australia where they were doing field trials.
Luckily, the escaped Khaleesi virus had already gone through rigorous testing to avoid unexpected impacts.
And again, it was spectacularly successful. It knocked down populations by over 90% in some areas.
Khaleesi virus is spread by flies feeding on dead rabbits. Unlike Myxoma, it doesn't need to keep its host alive, so it probably won't become less virulent over time. But rabbits could still evolve resistance.
When rabbits being rabbits, you only need to miss a few and they'll build up again.
So Australia's using every tool they've got.
Controlling invasive animals is not a solution that gives everyone the warm and fuzzy feelings, but if you don't do it, the problem isn't going to go away.
Which leaves Australians in a tough spot.
You don't forget the sound of that crack when the rabbit's neck's broken. And even as a 7-year-old, I knew that the rabbits were decimating the populations of native animals and plants that I loved. But I could also see that those rabbits were themselves living things. It's a very conflicted story for Australians.
Humans change the world, sometimes without even trying, and often in ways we never intended. So we're stuck making tough choices like this, with no easy answers. That's just part of the human footprint. Thanks for watching. If you want to see more, you can tune in to the full-length series on the PBS app or on your local PBS station. Check out the link in the description to find out more about the show.